All right, welcome to the President's Day edition of Pastor with No Answers. And, you know, some of our listeners, you're always looking for the next theological, spiritual debate or discussion. And so maybe you're just like, oh, man, presidents, really? Well, first of all, I can do whatever I want to on Me and My Brother's podcast. We make the calls. And secondly, presidents is just so interesting. Like, I love studying presidents. I'm not that smart with them, but I've read some books and it's just so interesting. But for those of you that you're just never happy without theology and Bible and spirituality, let me help you out. So let's think of Washington as God the Father, Lincoln as Jesus, Andrew Jackson as the Christian Crusades. And then I tell you what, for a lot of evangelicals on Facebook, it seems like maybe Obama is the Antichrist and Trump is the second coming of Christ.
So, that's pretty sobering, man.
Yeah.
All of that was pretty sobering. Yeah.
Yeah, anyway. For real.
All right. Well, basically, Jack, first thing I want to ask you is you had a really tough time in seeing this as the five greatest presidents, and I thought your thought process was super interesting. So, kind of walk us through why it was hard to think of it as the five greatest.
Well, because I think, you know, for one thing, there are two very different things that we think about when we think about what constitutes presidential greatness. One of them is, you know, what kind of results did the president achieve? What was the president's term like, or terms? Some of that's just luck of the draw.
Yeah.
You know, like, I think you could look at Bill Clinton and say he had a very successful two terms.
Right.
He, you know, the economy grew. He did a lot of small ball things that were, effective. But he was, you know, I think you'd have to say in terms of timing, he was very fortunate. He came into office just as a recession was ending, and he kind of got credit for the expansion that took place afterwards. And he left just as a recession was starting, and his predecessor kind of got blamed for it,
yeah.
You know, or his successor kind of got blamed for it. I mean, I'm not trying to diminish Bill Clinton. I respect him as a president. I think he was actually a pretty good president. He took what he played the hand he was dealt.
Yeah.
And played it well.
Yeah.
But he wasn't playing a really challenging hand.
Yeah.
And, you know, there are other presidents like that, like a Calvin Coolidge is another guy I would look at and say, you know, he was fortunate to live during a pretty benign period. And the good news is he wasn't going crazy trying to stir things up. I mean,
right.
He kind of just sat there. He didn't have to keep moving.
Silent Cal.
Yeah. Yeah. He was a good fit for the time. On the other hand, you have some people who, you know, if you said who were the most significant presidents for good or ill, right? It's like, how would you rank hurricanes? I mean, it's not because they're good things, but
right.
It's based on size and
right.
impact. And, you know, Andrew Jackson would be the classic example of somebody who you got to say he was very consequential, whether you think he was a good president or whether you think he was a horrible president.
Yeah.
You know, there are people on both sides of that one.
Yeah. So, Jared, let me let you take a guess. Jack and Robbie's top three are exactly the same, other than number one and number two are switched. So see if you can name the top three presidents of these two smart guys' lists.
Washington, Lincoln, and FDR.
Goodness, perfect. And that FDR is what really surprises me. I always thought he was a great president, but then I'd say like the last few things that I've read about him or commentary that I've heard about him, people really gave him a hard time. Obviously, ultra conservatives. But yeah, I want to get into that. And then, so Robbie had Lincoln at number one, then Washington, then FDR, then Teddy Roosevelt. And I'll read this. He said, then a muddle of fifth place guys, just like Jack, and we'll hear his in a second. He was going to say Eisenhower, but that's probably recency. Am I saying that right? Bias, and it should be Jefferson. And then some other mentions, honorable mentions, would be Truman, Reagan, Monroe. With Jack, Washington number one, Lincoln number two, FDR number three, Reagan number four instead of Teddy Roosevelt, And then there's a tie for number five, Teddy Roosevelt, Eisenhower, Truman. So what really started me in thinking about this episode, Jack said something to me that really intrigued me a few months ago, and it was your nephew that asked?
My son.
Your son. Okay, go ahead.
I can't remember how the topic came up, but he said, top five presidents that you would pick to lead during any kind of circumstance.
You know,
war or peace, you know, depression, expansion, whatever. And my answer was Washington, number one, hands down, nobody close.
Yeah. Yeah.
After that, it's kind of like there are lots of, you know, it gets difficult because everybody else has more obvious flaws as a leader. But
so what about Washington makes you say that?
Exactly. That's what I want to know.
So, you know, you look at him. So what I would say is, to me, Washington was one of the great executives, like a great executive leader.
Yeah.
Great judgment, the ability to really be patient, to have smart people around him. I would argue smarter people than he was. And he would have, you know, a guy who could have Hamilton and Jefferson both in his inner circle, listen to them both and make wise decisions.
Yeah.
Thing is, both of those guys, incredibly brilliant. But if you were coming, like if you had a monumental decision to make and you didn't want it to be screwed up, my view is you'd pick Washington to make it over either of those two, smart as they were.
Yeah.
You know, he just had that ability to walk through things wisely. And, you know, I think because of, you know, it's like one of the things about history that's hard is we can never... We know the end before we start to study the beginning.
Yeah.
And so we can never fully recapture what it was not to know the end.
Right.
And I, you know, to me, as I think about Washington, it's astonishing what he did. You know, first of all, you know, he led a revolt against the world's superpower.
Yeah.
My analogy would be if Mississippi and Alabama decided that they were seceding and then they won. You'd think the guy who led that was, wow.
Right.
Who's that guy? Right. So he did that. And then he stepped down, which was just, I don't think we can, because we know he did it and that's part of our heritage, I don't think we grasp how astonishing that was.
Like an act of humility?
Yeah, I agree with that.
To step down?
Is yeah.
That yeah.
Yeah.
It's now, so we have this whole, you know, so we had this dramatic shift of Obama to Trump, right? And like all during the inauguration, they're like, the announcer was like, look at this peaceful transfer of power. Like it was a big deal. And nowadays that's normal. We have that all over the world. We shouldn't pat ourselves on the back today just for doing that. But the idea of somebody who could have, you know, done whatever he wanted,
yes,
to just say, I'm gonna stop after 8 years to show that we shouldn't have one person in charge forever was a completely radical idea. Completely radical.
Yes.
It took humility and guts to do that.
So Rob,
I think that's a great legacy, one of his great legacies.
Yeah.
However, I had to make the call to not give him credit for the entire war during the presidency debate. So, I can't give him credit for basically the entire revolution while having the great presidents debate. But he's probably the greatest American because you have to roll all those things together.
Yeah.
But I agree with everything. The humble, like to me, like humble leadership, like to see in my Hillary pod, I was saying like, I want someone who will surround themselves with experts and make wise decisions. And he's like a paragon of that, right?
Yeah. Well, here in a second, I want to know, you know, why Abraham Lincoln came out on top. Jared, do you have something you want to say real quick?
I was just going to say too. What do you think is fair to say that Washington really didn't have to, or didn't have the distraction of, you know, the political games that they experience today, like our candidates today?
Well, certainly it was a different world, and you know,
right,
you could argue would Washington have adapted well to party politics? I mean, it's you know, one of the things that circumstances are incommensurable. It's so hard to, I mean, if he was living in our time, he would be a different person with different influences, you know.
Sure.
So okay. That's a hard question to answer. It's a legitimate one because you're right, he didn't really have to face that.
All right, so Robbie, Jack said not even close, Washington number one. Why would you beg to differ?
Well, again, it's all framing.
First of all, let me just say,
yeah.
Let me just say, clarify That was not greatest president.
That's right.
That was a different question.
Right. Who would you want to be in the driver's seat?
Regardless of the circumstances.
Gotcha. Yep.
And I would I would just say Washington had an opportunity to develop, to demonstrate a wide range.
Yeah.
And Lincoln never had that opportunity. Lincoln faced the greatest crisis, but you know, Washington had a longer career as a national leader.
Yeah.
So anyway, that's all. Yeah. I'm sorry. Robbie, go ahead. I didn't mean to interrupt. I just wanted
to... No, it's fine. So that's where I'm going. You know, so it's all in framing. Like, how do you frame the greatest? So like, so as a kind of metaphor, like, or analogy, whatever it is, like, so I'm a sports guy, right? Like, I used to work in the NFL. Like, I think Tom Brady is the greatest quarterback of all time on like just pure stats over the years.
Right.
But if I had to pick one guy to win one game, it probably wouldn't be him. It'd probably be
Aaron Rodgers. I don't know, totally Aaron Rodgers. I mean, that's cool, but
who would it be?
You can make a case to Aaron Rodgers, but like it wouldn't be Tom Brady in my mind. So who to me, like,
just out of curiosity,
for me,
yeah,
I think so. I would say Steve Young. As far as folks that I've seen in my 30s,
I'd probably say Joe Montana.
I like Joe more than Montana.
I'm really old school, so I'd say like Otto Graham, but that's cool.
Yeah, that's the typical approach is Johnny Unitas. Anyhow, so the point is, like, you know, the question matters and the circumstances matter. So for me, like, measuring the presidency, like, yeah, it's all about situational,
yeah,
like, difficulty. And so, you know, Lincoln faced this tremendous crisis, virtually impossible, and everything he did. There's some, obviously not everything was done right, but so many things were done right. And even then, they barely eked out the Union surviving. And so, you know, would Washington have survived there? Like, maybe, you know, like, I don't know. But like, I think that to get through that war, get through the abolition movement, passing the amendment to abolish slavery, all these things, and keeping the Union, even if tenuously, together, is the greatest single thing someone's done as president. And so to me, it's like 1A, 1B, like it depends on how you frame the question, but they really are, like, I was with my email, like there's kind of the top two. And then I think FDR stands alone as the bronze medalist. And then there's like this whole tier below them. So I don't feel like debating Montana versus Brady, excuse me, debating Washington versus Lincoln is necessarily worth, you know, getting your hair torn out over, because they're both clearly great in their own way.
Yeah. So, I mean, both of y'all, it sounds like Washington and Lincoln part, and this probably goes back to, you know, Jack really wanting to clarify exactly what his list is, and that is Washington and Lincoln inherited great challenge, and so they were able to flourish. I mean, you know, if you put Washington as the 13th president of the United States, I don't think there's anything big going on then. Maybe, mm-hmm. maybe. But, you know, definitely did not have the challenges. He would not have the challenges.
Well, I agree with that. Well, it's funny. I read an essay on greatness a number of years ago in Harvard Business Review, of all places. And it really sparked a lot of thought. And, you know, like, I was kind of like, so what are the components? And frankly, one of them is opportunity.
Yeah.
There are some people who may have everything, but they don't have the opportunity to be put in a position of enormous challenge.
Right.
And, like, to me, one of the exemplars of that, in one sense, is Harry Truman, who both of us rated highly. Harry Truman was a very ordinary guy, not a very talented guy, in my opinion. But, boy, talk about a guy who rose to the challenge, again, in an incredibly difficult time. And it, like, just pure seriousness, the seriousness with which he took his responsibility, the humility with which he was willing to bring in people who, again, were, you know, he viewed as being, you know, smarter than he was.
Yeah.
You know, just the way that he walked through it with courage. I have a lot of admiration for that.
Yeah.
I mean, I think that's an example of one where you have a fairly ordinary person with the character to rise to a supreme occasion.
Yeah. Robbie, how do you feel about, and I want to hear Jack too, and you too, Jared, how do y'all feel about his decision to drop the bombs to end the war? I mean, I've heard two compelling sides of that.
So I studied nuclear proliferation pretty closely in college, and I think the question of the bomb versus the bombs is actually a very different question. I think you can make a very compelling case for the first bomb as just a way to save net lives, very utilitarian, like end of the war more quickly, avoid a drawn out conflict. The second bomb, I don't think history shines well upon it because it seems unnecessary.
That's interesting.
And so it was destruction of both human lives. It was also a huge cultural center. They were, you know, if you believe, and who knows, this could be revisionist history, but like, we now think for the most part they would have conceded either way after the first bomb as the show of power. So, but again, like, you know, do you judge someone for making that call then? Like, he didn't know that. He didn't know they were drawing up, you know, in terms of surrender. But the first bomb, I think that there's a strong case for it. The case against it, I guess, would be less about that conflict where it seems pretty clear and more about the, you know, breaking the seal on nukes for the rest of time. Like, now that they're kind of out in the world, like, yeah, what's the risk factor that goes beyond the war and into the future?
Yeah, I think that's a very good assessment, Robbie. I would tend to maybe give more grace in the second bomb with the things that you acknowledged, which is that he didn't know. You know, that's one of the challenges of leadership, is that you're always facing limited knowledge and yet the need to make decisions within a certain time frame.
How far apart were they? Was it days, hours?
Yes, days.
Days, okay.
I don't remember exactly, but I want to say it was like 10 days apart, I could be wrong on that.
How about you, Jared?
Yeah, I guess I always thought that it was, at least the first bomb was the way to go, just because it would save a lot of American lives. Right. And then as far as the second bomb goes, I'm not sure what history says about how close Japan was to surrendering, so I don't know.
Yeah.
It's right. 3 days.
3 days, gotcha.
So that's a pretty tight window for someone to respond, right?
Yeah. Yeah, good point.
So that's right. You know, if it was a month or whatever, 6 months later, it's very different than, like, you know, bang, bang. Like, they're still probably just waking up from the shock of it all. And now, the second one hits.
Now, was that decision any sort of departure from what FDR possibly would have done? Or,
boy, who knows?
Yeah. Okay. All right. So yeah.
I have a question about FDR. So both of you have FDR at 3. So is that more because of his policies or the legacy he left with his policies? Either one of you.
I can go first and then Jack can speak more eloquently than I will. I think FDR, there's a lot of points to it. One is just like, it was a trying time and he was the president for a long time, right? He was the longest serving president by far and got us through a war. So you have kind of like the leader in tough times element, the Churchillian element. The policies mattered, like the expansion, like, you know, I'm generally progressive. So the expansion of the welfare state, Social Security, that kind of thing is positive. You know, the New Deal infrastructure, like giving folks jobs and helping the country in the process, that had a permanent, literal, like physical impact. So to me, it's like on all those things combined. It's not one thing. It's not like he was an idealist. Like, we'll get to Reagan later. You know, part of Reagan's greatness, I presume Jack will say, is like kind of setting the tone for the conservative movement. FDR has that, but he's not just a totem. He has a huge legacy, and lots of things happened under that umbrella.
Yeah, and he was dealt a really shitty hand too. So,
yeah.
Well, yeah. See,
if your hand is terrible, you know, you're generally going to look better on the other end, right? Because
right,
eventually things get better, or else the world ends. So we shouldn't give him endless credit for, like, I mean, you can save the economy by just, like, you know, building lots of tanks and airplanes and going to war for and killing a million people. Like, that's not a great way to boost the economy if you can avoid it. So yeah, he had a bad hand, and that, you know, he both gets credit for that, but also gets kind of a stacked deck in his favor in a weird way in this debate. So it's tricky.
Yeah. I have very mixed feelings about FDR. You know, I was putting together a whole bunch of lists just as I was trying to think about this topic, and
we will definitely get to him too. Boy,
he's on my most overrated list too. In the sense that, like, I rank him as highly as he did because I would argue that the Second World War was the largest event in human history, and he led the winning coalition, and what, you know, like, you can't underrate that, and coalitions are tough, and you know, and
especially
and,
with the personalities in that coalition.
Well, the personalities,
right? Like Stalin,
the very different agendas, you know.
Yeah.
you know, I think the economic record is more of a mixed bag. You know, my opinion economically is that the Great Depression was as bad as it was, in part because of his mistakes.
Oh, wow.
Now, at the same time, though, I got to look at it and say, nobody knew what to do. And one of the things about him was he wasn't afraid to try things. And, you know, to your point, Robbie, he was the president for longer than anybody else by a wide margin. Dealt a very difficult hand at a time when nobody knew what to do. Is it surprising that he made some mistakes? No. And like, it's foolish to hold those against him. Now, I also think that he had some character flaws that played out. Of course, everybody has character flaws. But as in terms of greatness as a human being, I have trouble ranking him with a Lincoln.
But you did it.
Well, I ranked him below.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, I think Robbie and I are both saying Washington and Lincoln probably head and shoulders above the rest. And I would agree with that.
Yeah.
FDR is just a really complex person. And I went to his home last fall.
Yeah.
The FDR library is there. Like, it just gave me a picture of the guy. So he lived in his mother. That was his mother's house. He lived with his mom all his life.
Wow, his whole life.
She didn't die until 1941 or 42, I think.
Did his wife live with his mom too? Then
yes.
Wow.
Yes, he built a wing when he was married onto the family home, and there were like adjoining bedrooms, his mom's and his and his wife's, with a sitting room in between. It was just kind of fascinating. Now, and she wasn't a monster. He was an only child.
Yeah.
She was like 26. His dad was like 52 when he was born. So she kind of ruled the house and she ruled him.
Yeah.
And so the fact that he was a very devious person, yes, you could understand that. He kind of had to be growing up. You know, I mean, it just kind of gave me a different picture of him, you know, and more of an understanding of what shaped him as a person.
Yeah.
Anyway, that's a horrific digression, I'm sure. But I'm
all right. So Robbie, Teddy Roosevelt at number four, and he definitely made Jack's tie for number five. I'm not even close to the historian that you guys are. Is he an exception? Because as far as he's not making this list because of a major challenge, or is there something that I'm overlooking?
Robbie, you want to go ahead?
Sure. I mean, like, again, this is where, to me, these guys all kind of have a whole tier to themselves.
Yeah.
But yes, I was sort of like trying to say, like, what is this greatness, you know, like what makes someone great, right? And it's kind of like these presidents all have some themes in common. One is like they make the nation greater, or they help with like troubling times, a war, a crisis, whatever. Or the third thing, which is kind of like less important but still a really big deal, is like set some key precedents on policy or on a movement, or just like set an example, right? So like Washington stepping down, that's setting an example for the future generations of leadership. So to me, Teddy is probably more in that last bucket of like kind of like things that are policy and like a movement oriented example setting. So, you know, massively expanding the conservation effort with national parks, spearheading the progressive movement. He didn't get that far because he was constantly fighting Congress in doing so. But, you know, I was telling a friend, I was saying, if you like Trump, you would have loved Teddy, right? because, you know, he hated the corporatocracy, whatever, with every fiber of his being, and he fought it tooth and nail in a very authentic way. We'll see how authentic Trump will fight it. But, you know, the progressive movement really evolved out of him in certain ways. So he has some policy wins, some movement wins, and some actual, like, kind of like things he did, be it the conservation movement, and also just some cool big time stuff to change the world, like the Panama Canal, like changed trade, right, for all of time. And it helped the Western US and the US broadly to be a big manufacturing powerhouse, and a trade powerhouse, which it couldn't have been otherwise. I'm sure Asia is also very thankful. So it changed the world. And so, you know, and he has his demerits, but and one thing you guys mentioning earlier, talking about like what makes someone great, it could be the era. Like one thing that's also tricky is like, you know, you do one thing really wrong, and you kind of fall off the list, right? Mm-hmm. So there's a lot. One fun list I think to go over with Jack spontaneously, that'd be like, who are the presidents who would have been really good if not for that one thing they did that really, really sucked. I think that he avoided any of those major pitfalls while also having a lot of, like, he was hitting singles and doubles pretty consistently.
Yeah.
Well, you know, I thought your comment about comparing him to Trump was hilarious. I haven't heard anybody do that, but you're right. Like, in terms of, like, the need for attention. So I think it was Henry Cabot Lodge that said of Theodore Roosevelt, Theodore wants to be the bride at every wedding and the corpse at every funeral.
That's hilarious.
But you're right. He was just a powerhouse. And, you know, my thing is America became a great power under him.
Wow.
And
we're talking 1902, 03-ish.
Yeah, naval expansion, that kind of thing.
Yeah. Gotcha. Yeah. Well, and just the ability to assert power and to project power and like the concept of here's who we are in the world now, you know. But I also agree with you. I think, you know, you didn't use these terms, but he was kind of a boundary breaker, you know. So his activism was really a new thing for presidents. And as you said, he didn't get very far with it, but he made it possible for the people who came after him to go further.
Was he the guy that said, speak softly and carry a big stick?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Well, I'm super interested in this question, Robbie, as a Hillary Clinton supporter, and I think you described yourself as more liberal. I don't want to put words in your mouth. Did you say that earlier?
More liberal than the guys in the show.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Here in Silicon Valley, I get branded as being too conservative. When I go visit my family in upstate Michigan, they think I'm a communist. So I can please everyone a little bit, and I can also disappoint everyone a little bit. But I'm certainly on the progressive side.
Gotcha. Well, that Reagan making your honorable mention list, man, that's actually a shock, just because more than anything, I hear, you know, Democrats and liberal just throwing stones at that guy. I mean, he's kind of the go-to for our generation of politics to go after, because he's, you know, probably considered the most recent, most successful Republican president, like, in the last 20, 30 years. So what's up with that?
What's up with Reagan being on my honorable mentions?
Yep. I mean,
like, first of all, like, that gets down to, like, 10, 11, 12 guys, something like that. Like, I don't think that he can fall out of the top 20. Like, and if one thing that I don't like is, like, if you're a conservative, not every conservative is awesome, and not every liberal is an idiot, right? And vice versa. And, like, so you're going to have Dan Koch on later on, the Depolarized podcast. He's a good friend of mine. And, you know, I do the same thing. Like, if you can't see the benefit of someone who might not have the same, like, policy leanings as you, you're missing the point. Like, on the Hillary pod, I said, right, there's three big things for the president. One is, like, to make a leader in times of crisis. One is to make policy. And one is to, like, be the commander in chief. And, like, the policy things are most of the liberal versus conservative stuff comes in. That's only a third of the job, in my opinion, right? And so, yeah, I'm not a big trickle down economics guy or whatever, but, like, that I shouldn't let that taint the whole legacy for me.
Yeah.
Plus, I knew that if I said he was, like, bottom five worst, then, like, it'd just be me and Jack yelling for, like, an hour. That would get nowhere.
So what about Reagan do you find endearing or redeemable?
Why doesn't Jack tell us why he's so great, and then I'll just tell you which parts I agree with?
All right. Works for me.
Well, you know, of course, one of the things that's a little different with me than the three of you guys is that I'm a lot older.
Right.
So I'm 60.
You were there.
Yeah, well, and I was, he was the first president that entered office at a point where I was actually out of college, had begun my career, and was, you know, and those were depressing times, and you know what, a lot of people arguing, you know, we've just gotten to the point where really nobody could be president and make it work, you know, it's just impossible, and I think not only did the U.S. a lot of people in the world perceived the U.S. being in decline, but I think Americans generally felt we were in decline.
And this is because of Carter, Ford, and Nixon?
I don't want to blame any one person for it, but there was a lot of, you know, just bad economic policy.
Yeah.
You know, there was, you know, Carter was a very hesitant leader in the international stage. And before him, Ford, you know, the way he came into office, he had no, you know, he had no stroke. He had no ability really to do anything. So from the point that Nixon, you know, kind of came under attack in 72, he had 2 years where he was immobilized from like 72 to 80.
Yeah.
You know, the U.S. in terms of international leadership was just very weak and uncertain.
Yeah.
And so, you know, Reagan created, you know, what it seemed like a new economic paradigm and started the economy on a, you know, an upswing that lasted for a couple of decades, really. And then he won the Cold War. And I will just tell you, you know, growing up during that period, if you had polled people and said, do you ever think that this is going to end? Very few people would have said it's even possible. Now, I'm not trying to say that was a miracle. Obviously, one of the things we now know on the other side, kind of like to your point about revisionist history, is how weak the Soviet Union really was in some important respects. But,
right.
But you know, the other thing was the resolute leadership, like the evil empire speech.
Yeah.
You know, like people are like, you're out of your... But, you know, he called a spade, you know, and he... And the thing is, what we didn't see, but was going on, was that he was strengthening the hands of, like, the resistance movements throughout Eastern Europe, because they thought, like, this guy gets it. I mean, it was an evil empire, and he was willing to say so. So anyway, that's kind of my deal. And, what I would also say is, you know, having lived through that, I probably overrate the importance of it. You know, it causes me to, you know, look at that and probably... Reagan was not a brilliant guy, don't think.
Gosh, that's interesting. I always thought he was just super smart.
But he was a great communicator, though.
Super charismatic, yeah. More than smarty smart.
Yeah. Well, the thing is, he knew what he thought. He knew his own mind, you know? And so he was able to communicate with real power because of that. Anyway. Yeah.
Robbie, what do you say to that then? Because now that...
Yeah, so that's all fair. So what I kind of push back on is, like, I don't love the Reagan worship you hear these days, and largely because it's often separated from the guy himself, right? Like, I mean, here's the guy who, if he was around today, he would want some kind of comprehensive immigration reform bill that included, quote-unquote, amnesty plus border security. Like, he actually raised taxes, like, 7 different times, and everyone's like the Reagan brand has become used, like you slap it on any kind of idea and go, this is Reagan approved, therefore it's conservative orthodoxy. And like, you know, I think he was a good leader for his time. He has some stains, like the AIDS movement or the AIDS epidemic and the blind eye, I think, was a big issue. Iran-Contra is not great. I actually like George H.W. Bush a whole lot and think that he's an underrated president, but also the economic recession that came late in his term is probably somewhat due also to like the momentum that I've been building during Reagan's later period. So it's not just Bush's fault, like he came into office on one day and then the economy became the Bush economy, not the Reagan economy. Mm-hmm. So I think that he's fine. And and the movement is very real. And I think it matters that he inspired people to believe in the presidency, which is, I totally agree. Like the presidency was just kind of shot at that point in time after all it had gone through. And so that matters. And for that reason, like I said on my last pod appearance, like, I know that this will make Jack just roll over. I really think that a lot of my generation, especially on the liberal side, will look at Obama in the same way. Because even if it's just like they like him and they believe in him and he's a good orator, like he got them engaged, and that matters. Mm-hmm. Reagan will probably have a longer lasting policy influence. We'll see how the whole Obamacare thing sorts out. But you know, those things matter too. So yeah, like he's certainly up there for me. I just don't think that he belongs in this kind of like, you know, winged angel figure that we've made.
I couldn't agree more. And you're right. You know, if more of today's conservatives knew some of the things that Reagan actually supported, they'd be appalled. I actually, you know, Robbie, I remember your discussion of Reagan when we had our podcast on before the election. And I think your view of him is very fair.
So are we living in a majorly different world if the assassination attempt on Reagan succeeds? Was that 81? Does anybody know?
It was 81, yeah.
81?
That's a great question.
Yeah, who the heck knows?
Yeah. I thought you knew, Jack.
I mean, I like Bush, but the question is like, I mean, for me, it's less of like, could Bush have done that? I mean, I think because we now know how weak the Soviets were, right? Like, that union still falls under a George H.W. Bush presidency. But like, how does an assassination change just the world in general?
Yeah.
Right? Like, they've started world wars. So I think it's almost like you can't measure the ripples of that pebble in the pond, because like that would just have all kinds of effects on fear and on over-response and that kind of thing.
One of the things that's interesting that that Reagan was great at, he was great at projecting confidence. And that was also one of the things that FDR was great at. You know, like the fireside chats. He was great at connecting with people and having them believe that here's a guy who understands what the issues are and who I can trust to move forward with, you know? And George H.W. Bush, he just didn't have that. Very few people do. I think, you know, the thing with Bush is he had so much knowledge and experience. He was really one of the great foreign policy presidents in a lot of ways. But I don't think economics wasn't as much interest to him. And I don't think he was as confident in his grasp of it.
Right. That's fair.
All right. Before we move on, I have a question that it just blows my mind, and definitely did not tell y'all this question was coming, but curious, why do you guys think that so few presidents are assassinated? And I know it sounds crazy, but it just seems like we have a lot of crazies out there that all it takes is just one person getting in one place. I mean, can we just chalk it up to we have unbelievable national security that protects the president? I mean, I know this sounds nuts, but I'm surprised Donald Trump is still alive. Like, right now. I mean, there's so many people that hate him and so many people that would love to go down in history, even if they had to rot in jail for the rest of their lives for killing the president. And there's got to be people that would love to do that. I mean, is that a crazy question? As far as so few presidents, what, just three? McKinley, Garfield, JFK? Am I right?
Lincoln,
yeah.
My boy Lincoln. I don't think that's a crazy question. I mean, like, we had attempts a lot more in the past, right?
Yeah.
I do think that nowadays it really is a matter of we have this just substantially increased Secret Service, you know, group. And we have, like, nowadays you couldn't plan that kind of thing without being picked up in some way, unless you were a total lone wolf, like a Lee Harvey Oswald type. And even and now, like, that kind of event, like, the protections are so much greater. Like, you hear about the level of preparation for any kind of speech or parade, like, when they're canvassing off miles and miles and miles. I'm a little amazed personally that, Trump's been in office for 14 days. Like, I mean, the Obamas being the first ever African-American, yeah, first family, had, I think it was like three times the number of, like, recorded threats on their family as anybody else has. And, like, we never heard of any of them.
Yeah.
And so that to me speaks to, for better or for worse, the surveillance state, and, you know, increased protections there, because if anyone, I felt like they are probably more in danger than Trump, because, like, the folks who hate Trump are like, you're kind of like, you know, you're a liberal snowflake progressive type. Like, I mean, the increase in activity.
Way to stereotype, like, man.
And these are my friends, man. These are my homies. You know, we saw, if you read, like, the Southern Poverty Law Center or whatever it's called, like, the number of the quote unquote anti-government militant groups, like the sort of, like, general, like, not necessarily white power, but, like, the kind of, like, anti-establishment, they surged the last 8 years. And so, I thought we were going to have an attack on his life. It's a minor miracle, in my opinion, that he didn't have anything.
Yeah.
So I'm guessing, I mean, but the budget for this kind of stuff nowadays must be billions, billions of dollars. Yeah.
But you're right. I would agree with you. It's kind of like the, why don't we have more terrorist attacks?
Yeah.
Same reason.
Yeah.
It's the surveillance
thing. Oh, yeah. We were in New York City when Obama drove through, and it was just unreal. I mean, there were certain areas, a lot of places we could not even get close to. So yeah. It was all right. Well, let's touch on some of Jack's mini lists, and I would love to hit every single president that makes these lists, but we'll just touch on some of them. But I'll give, I guess everybody has this list. I was gonna play a little guessing game, but overrated president. I want to hear this JFK overrated president.
Well, just, he's rated as one of the great presidents, and he just wasn't. I
right.
mean, and you know, I wouldn't argue that he didn't have the potential to be, perhaps. I'm not negative or hostile to him as a leader, but he was president for 2.5 years, didn't accomplish a lot, really.
Right.
And so, you know, to have him rated as one of the great presidents, it just
Do you think people get confused? They confuse success with charisma and influence and belovedness. I mean,
maybe. I mean, although, you know, it's hard to, the Kennedys just have this glamour that, you know, kind of overshadows everything, and not sure what all goes into that, but
yeah.
But you know, he's kind of unique in that regard in terms of this guy who's highly regarded totally apart from anything he actually accomplished. And I'm not saying he accomplished nothing.
It's the mystique of Camelot.
Yeah. If only I could think of a recent example where people conflated charisma with success and intelligence. I can't think of any.
How do you feel? Actually, how do you assess JFK, Robbie?
He's my number one overrated also.
Yeah.
With the bullet, but like by far. So I read some like poll of like the American Political Scientist Association, whatever, and they also called him the most overrated. I mean, yeah, short term, you know, inspirational, like the space race speeches was awesome, put a man on the moon, that kind of thing. Obviously it's not his fault that he was assassinated. I mean, damn near ended the world with the Cuban Missile Crisis.
Yeah, right.
So like, and at the same time, like he did call out the dogs there. So like, so you kind of, do you give credit or do you say we shouldn't have been in that position in the first place?
Kind of both.
So I don't get the hero worship. And I just think that, yeah, it's the glamour of like the family and like that we wanted someone to hold on to at that time, like to view as like our leaders who had it all under control. They were beautiful. They were wonderful. They were smart. They're charismatic. And also like, you know, just like, I think that musicians who die young become glorified. Like, I think that we kind of canonize presidents who don't get to live into making their mistakes, right? So you can call him the Kurt Cobain of presidents.
Yeah, but Kurt Cobain was not overrated.
Oh, he's no got way. You on that one, right?
No way.
He's got you on that one.
Elliot Smith, whatever. Like, I don't care who it is. Right?
Why's it got to be suicide, fellas?
Kurt Cobain had the Metallica run of the 90s or the U2 run of the early 2000s, you would not feel that way, right? He just didn't have the chance to make that mistake.
Dude, you had me confused at Steve Young. All right, we got to move on. underrated presidents. This is interesting. I've got something I obviously have to admit, and yet this probably doesn't surprise y'all, but there's a good, I'd say 15 presidents I know absolutely nothing about. And I would say the only thing I know about Garfield's on another list. Only thing I know about McKinley is that he's assassinated. I know nothing about Grover Cleveland, except I think he's on the $1,000 bill. Polk.
Served two non-consecutive terms in office, too.
That's right.
Oh, really? So he got voted in twice?
Yeah.
Nice.
And the time
and
in between.
He counts as two presidents.
Yes.
So if
on
we're on the
45, that's two rovers in there.
All right. So what are we on right now? 45th.
Yeah, 44th human being, but 45th president because Grover comes.
I did
comes
not
alive.
Know that. I just yes. learned something. Wow.
Nice.
How many years apart were his terms?
Just four. He lost to Benjamin Harrison in between,
wow.
And not by much. Yeah.
So there's nothing in our laws that say president. Obviously, I mean Obama could run again.
Yes.
Why doesn't that happen more often? They're just tired, probably.
Tired. Yeah, and old too. I mean, you know, Obama's fairly unusual in terms of having come to office at a relatively young age. But you know, most other guys, if you come in your 50s and you stay until your 60s, and then you got to at least keep out for a term. You know, you're pushing 70 at that point, and do you really want to do that again?
I am so surprised Bill Clinton hasn't tried it.
Yeah, yeah.
All right. So, underrated president. Let's touch on Eisenhower. How do you feel about that, Robbie? That made the most underrated presidents on Jack's list.
Yeah, I mean, like, so I said in my email that he was like my initial gut feeling was he's number five, but that could be recency bias.
Yeah.
And it should be Jefferson. I actually went back last night and I was like, no, I think he really is my number five over Jefferson. Like, Ike was awesome. And actually, I had a fun question for Jack, which is for this particular era in time where we have a growing but sluggish economy, we have this kind of reemerging like divisiveness at home domestically on policy and on kind of racial stuff. We have a maybe looming conflict with like Russia and China and the world. What president would you draft from the past to be president now? Wow. I think Ike would work really well right now, for example.
Mm-hmm.
Like steady hand at the wheel, absolutely killer, like foreign affairs and military understanding. Doesn't overreact domestically. Just like he was just did a good job, like through and through and through. He gets forgotten in that second half of the 21st century in the kind of between, you know, FDR and Reagan window. We kind of forget everyone in that window.
Yeah.
But I would say that he really stands out there. And, you know, I was reading about him last night. He was like Gallup's most admired man in America, like 12 different years in their polling. Like he was a beloved figure, and not just for his wartime experience, but like I think that Ike was, he was great.
Well, and again, you know, so if you were to say, who are the American leaders who spent the most time, like at the very pinnacle of responsibility, it would be Washington and Eisenhower. And I agree with you. I think the one weakness he had, he wasn't a great communicator. He was a guy who had a lot of personal charisma. He was, you know, one of the things he was just known for in terms of people who met him never forgot that. But he, in fact, he was kind of mocked a lot for his speaking style. He was, you know, but I, you know, honestly, I think one of the things that was interesting about him, he wasn't highly rated as a president, but then when people understood really what was going on behind the scenes all the time, it was like, wow, you know, he kind of presented this image of, you know, this grandfatherly guy who wasn't really, you know, he'd kind of taken it easy. And like you said, he had as much geopolitical grasp as anybody who's ever had that office. He was a, he was a very skillful hand at the wheel. I think that's a good way to characterize him.
Yeah, you go through it, and it's like, so he had to navigate Taiwan and China, figuring out their issues. Sputnik got launched. He founded NASA.
Well, like, here's an interesting one, too.
And McCarthyism at home, right?
McCarthyism at home. The Suez Crisis. Your closest ally does something incredibly stupid. And what do you do? Without ruining your relationship with them, and yet without supporting them. I mean, he handled that masterfully.
Eisenhower, yeah, folks.
And also, like, I think it's pretty, and part of my scoring is, like, did someone just do, like, the right thing, even when it wasn't necessarily in their best interest? And it still, to this day, blows my mind that our greatest general of recent history, who oversaw the largest, in terms of scale, fighting force, his last words are, don't fall into this trap of the military-industrial complex, which we totally did, right? Mm-hmm. We totally ignored him and did it anyways. But like he had the prescience and the guts to say, like, against all those, and I'm sure he knew the CEOs of all of these contractors who build them tanks and planes and war machines, and he comes out and says, don't fall into this trap, guys. Like, this is a big deal.
Yeah. Well, you know, it's interesting, like, that ability. I think you're putting your finger on something really important, Robbie, which is kind of the ability to think outside your own box. You're right. There was every reason in the world for him to be so comfortable in that world that it was just natural to him. But he was able to stand outside himself enough to point out the danger. Like, my analogy there would be Washington essentially siding with Hamilton on economic policies as opposed to Jefferson, where he lived in Jefferson's world. You know, they had a very similar background. And here's this guy from New York with these really different ideas. And Washington's sense was, this is really the direction the country needs to go. Now, again, I realize there are, you could question whether that has been wholly beneficial. I'm not trying to make that argument. But his ability to stand outside himself and make a judgment like that, I think, you know, both of those guys were extremely unusual in that regard.
All right,
Newly minted liberal hero Hamilton, thanks to his musical. And also Eisenhower, he made the interstates, right? And interstate highways are a big deal in America. So, like, all these little things add up.
That's right. Well, the rest of the underrated presidents, you'll have to do your own research if you want to know why. Calvin Coolidge, Polk, McKinley, and Cleveland. Next, we have presidents who were undone by arrogance. And Robbie commented that there's not going to be a whole lot of fireworks on this episode, mainly because of the common ground that Jack and Robbie have on their list. But I have a feeling maybe there'll be some fireworks on this one. We got Jefferson, Woodrow Wilson, Obama, and Hoover. So, Robbie, I tell you what, Jack, why was he undone by arrogance, Obama?
Let's tell you what. Let's not talk about Obama.
Yeah.
Just because we've talked about him. And, you know, what I would also say is that I am too close to him to be objective about him. I think that's one of the things, like, why is good history not written until decades after the fact? Because it's too hard not to be influenced by what you've experienced. And, you know, as I acknowledged earlier, I would argue that I probably think more highly of Reagan than I should because I experienced what changed during the country during that part of my life. And I, you know, I would say that I'm more negative to Obama than he deserves. So, but let's talk about Jefferson, because he was on, he was one of your top lists. And that's my right. argument was that after JFK, he's my most overrated.
All right.
My thought there, I think Jefferson was a remarkable guy and a brilliant guy who was absolutely unsuited to be the executive of anything. He was a failure as the governor of Virginia during the Revolution. And as president, I think you could, it was a mixed bag. He did not screw up the Louisiana Purchase, which was a supremely big deal. And one that I would even argue that caused him to have to stand outside. If John Adams had tried to do what Jefferson did, like the specific actions that he took, he would have been screaming that they were unconstitutional. But he did them because he knew that this thing had to be done and he didn't screw it up. But his problem was, in so many areas, Jefferson is a brilliant guy who was in love with his own ideas and kind of wouldn't acknowledge when reality proved him wrong. You know, the great disaster of his presidency was triggered by the embargo of 1807. It was during the Napoleonic Wars. And there was this huge issue with impressment, you know, the British Navy pulling over American ships, claiming that, hey, Joey Svensson, you were on a Royal Navy, you're coming with us. And Jefferson kind of didn't want to do anything about it.
Yeah.
And he kept the problem kept getting worse. And he kept saying, you know, quit bullying us. And then his response ultimately was the embargo against the advice of the people that he really should have listened to, like Albert Gallatin, who was one of the great Treasury secretaries. And like my analogy is this. I say, Joey, stop bullying me. And you say, no. I say, Joey, if you don't stop bullying me, I'm going to start jabbing myself with a sharp stick. That was kind of what he did. And it led to an economic catastrophe. War with Britain happened anyway a few years later. I mean, it solved nothing and it wrecked a lot. And, you know, but that was his great weakness. He to the end of his life, he refused to realize, refused to acknowledge he was wrong. My another analogy there is, you know, he had a very harmful effect. Like, it was Jefferson's political theology that was the justification for the South's secession in the Civil War.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, he would never really admit that that didn't work, though he knew it, I think, by the end. Anyway.
Yeah. And I'm coming around on that point of view. Like, I was reading more last night, and I was like, you know, I think I just tossed Jefferson in there because of his general stature as, like, from the Declaration, the Revolution, through everything, you yep. know, being in First Secretary of State. And I give a lot of credence because, like, you know, the Louisiana Purchase is a big, big deal, as you mentioned. Yep. Like, I mean, you think about it. If America was just, like, the first 13 colonies of the Eastern Seaboard, we'd be this little dinky regional power. We'd be sticking, mm-hmm. like, a little Eastern nation sticking off this big landmass like Portugal sticking off of Europe.
Yes.
And so somehow we got all the way across and did many crimes to do so against Native peoples, which we should, you know, our boy Andrew Jackson can talk about that. But, you know, the Purchase began that Western movement, and it's an enormous sum of land. You look at it, you're like, holy cow. Like I was thinking the other day, like, can you imagine in the current era, if some country was like, hey, who wants to buy like a skajillion acres of land? Like, it would be crazy, right? And yet we somehow just like tripled the size of the country overnight.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Jefferson, I mean, I think it's really cool. I always on the $2 bill. That's awesome for me. So presidents.
He's the tip of the president.
All right, so last list that Jack came up with was presidents who were in over their heads, and got some of these guys on here that I know nothing about. I've heard of them, but I know nothing about Buchanan or Pierce. And let's talk. And then we have George W., John Adams, and Ulysses Grant. Let's talk about George Bush. And first of all, Jack, when you say in over their heads, is that would you say that's an insulting remark, or would you say, hey, they weren't up for the challenge? Or
yeah, I would say weren't up for the challenge. I mean, some of, like, Buchanan and Pierce were the two presidents before Lincoln.
Okay.
And they were just feckless leaders that did nothing to arrest the drift towards secession.
Gotcha.
And Buchanan in particular, just George W. Bush, like, I think a good man. Like, I don't, you know, the Bush lied. I don't think he lied. I think he was just wrong, you know, with the weapons of mass destruction. I think, you know, I originally thought he kind of understood how the economy worked, but, you know, he made a lot, and he did some good things, but he did a lot of boneheaded things, too.
Yeah.
It's like, I don't really think he got that either. I think he was a good man who tried his best and was just overmatched by an incredibly difficult job. John Adams tried to follow George Washington. That's a tough act to follow.
Right.
And party politics really started to emerge during his time, and he did not have the capacity, really, temperamentally, to manage that. U.S. Grant, he's just one of the puzzles of American history to me. I think if we were trying to rate greatest generals, I think you could make a good argument for him as the greatest general in American history.
Wow.
But boy, really struggled in civilian life, and really, his presidency was just kind of a mess.
Yeah.
I mean,
you got any pushback on any of that, Robbie?
Kind of. Yeah. So with Grant, the rest is all fine. You know, I think it's interesting. Like it's very in vogue, and it has been for a while now, like the last 100 years, to say that Grant was a crappy president. And I recently read some articles saying that, like, that probably is not quite the case. I mean, he's not going to ascend to that top tier or top two tiers, but I do want to just, I don't think he was a bad president. I think he was probably in over his head. His cabinet was racked with scandal.
Yeah.
But I mean, president during, I mean, the next hardest time to wartime, right, is right after the wartime, like your kind of Marshall Plan era of the war. And, you know, he had this, And you know, immediately post Lincoln, we did a terrible job, and we, like, the South was mishandled, and so Grant is trying to preside over this still fractured nation, but it's one nation, and you know, there's some things I think that he deserves credit for. So, for example, I had not realized until I was researching this that, you know, for a 55-year window, he was the only president to get elected twice, and so he was doing something right. Mm-hmm. And you know, yeah, there was a scandal. There's only thing like,
yeah, wait, you gotta be careful. He was the only, I mean, Lincoln was elected twice, but he didn't serve his two full terms, so he was the only president that served two full terms.
Yeah. You know, there's like Transcontinental Railroad, that kind of thing. He pushed civil rights stuff a little bit, but of course that was all just like carrying forward the momentum of the post-war effort. So I don't think that he was a bad president. I think
saying
I agree
with that.
Probably fine. I just want to give a little shout out to our boy Grant because he gets a bad rap.
I agree with that. I
some of the historians that I read say that this is part of, like, you know, the lost cause movement of the South, like how Robert E. Lee was really so great and noble, but Grant was the bad guy. Like, that became really in vogue for a long time. I mean, just now, as kind of this like racial, you know, stuff pops back up, with be it Ferguson or Black Lives Matter or the Muslim ban, whatever, and we kind of look back at history. It is important to recognize, like, the Civil War was about slavery, and Grant had a hell of a job to keep this thing from blowing up a second time. And just getting through that, I think, deserves some credit.
Yeah, like I said, I wouldn't argue that he was a terrible president. I just think he was in over his head. He just was never able to really, you know, get his job under control. Like you said, he was constantly having to deal with things like his cabinet issues that, it's just kind of funny. It's just puzzling with me, you know, because he was so effective as a military leader, and it just, the presidency just wasn't a fit in the same way. But I agree with you, he wasn't a catastrophe.
Yeah. Little trivia for you guys is that 1 million people went to his funeral in New York when he died.
Well, wow. Again, Grant's tomb. I mean, it's the most monumental tomb in the United States.
Why is that?
And most folks don't even know it's there.
Yeah. Right. Right.
That's unreal. Wow. Well, awesome. Awesome discussion. Thank you guys. Very interesting for me personally. Jared, you got anything you want to add or ask these guys? Do you get interested in this sort of stuff, right? I mean, I know it's not wheelhouse. You're more the science guy, but you like American history.
Oh, I totally enjoyed it. Absolutely, yeah, yeah.
Kind
of reminded me of my 10th grade U.S. history class. All these, I mean, because I kind of remember now through this conversation learning these little things here and there, but I just had forgotten all of it. So
yeah,
it's cool.
Yeah, next episode will be same sort of thing, except the most attractive first ladies. And
all right,
Martha Washington, I think, will make the...
No, it's Eleanor Roosevelt, dude.